Hello, welcome, and thanks for joining me for another book chat. You know, I don't read a lot of short story collections, and I'm not sure why that is. It's just they don't. It's not something that I normally pick up. But recently, I decided to read this collection from one of the masters, Death in Venice and Seven Other Stories by Thomas Mann, and I was not disappointed. This book was each of the stories have their own publication date. From what I can tell, this particular translation by H.T. Lowe Porter was either from 1930 or 1936. I'm not exactly sure which, but this particular vintage paperback edition came out in 1955. So, unfortunately, it came apart. I was almost finished reading it, and it came apart as I was reading it. I may try to tape this up and see if I can't still keep this for a while longer. But anyway, so Thomas Mann, you know, I read Joseph and His Brothers a few years ago and chatted that. I'll link to the chat down below. Thomas Mann considered that his magnum opus. So I figured I wasn't going to be disappointed in these stories and I wasn't, you know, they're just wonderful. I picked this book up in a charity shop sale a while back, so I've had it a while, but so glad that I got it read. How I thought I would approach this chat is just run through the stories real quick, what they are, and then maybe talk about a few more a little more in depth. So the first story in the collection is called Death in Venice, and it's probably the most famous one. It's got a date of 1911. It's basically about this man who's around 50 years old, who's a very successful writer and intellectual, public intellectual, who has spent his entire life in the service of this art, perhaps to the exclusion of other aspects of being human, you know? And so he ends up going to Venice, and he sees, across the room one morning, he sees a young boy, about a 14-year-old boy who is to him the personification of beauty itself, and it becomes obsessed with this boy. So that's what this story is about. I'll talk a little bit more about that story, this story here, a little later. But the second story in the collection is called Tonio Kruger, and it's from 1903. So Tonio, this is another artist story. Starts out with Tonio as a young boy, and he's got a sort of intellectual, artistic kind of bent. He's kind of got a crush on his best friend, and he wants his best friend to experience, whenever he reads something beautiful or something like that, he wants his best friend to experience that too. And his friend really just wants to look at books with maps in them and things like that, you know, not really interested in the intellectual side. So it didn't really, it's sort of a hard lesson for him to learn at this age. But then a couple few years later, he's kind of got a crush on this girl, and again, he finds himself unable to connect with her because doesn't share this sort of intellectual sort of view of life. And so he always finds himself on the outs. And then as an adult, he's actually found some friends, sort of, I guess, kindred spirits that are sort of bohemian. Ultimately, he needs to go back to his hometown as an adult, and he goes and he ends up seeing from afar and observing at a social function, his former best friend and this girl, and then sort of realizing that an artist is always sort of an outsider. So to me, that's what that story was about. The third story in the collection is called Mario and the Magician, and it's from 1929. This story was about a magician, really more like a hypnotist, who's giving this show in this town in Italy, and the magician is able to manipulate his audience, you know, through hypnotism and mesmerism, and get the audience to do things that they otherwise wouldn't do. Mario in the story is, I think he was a waiter, but, you know, as just a regular kind of working person who's in the audience, who gets called on, you know, to participate in the show, and doesn't turn out well in the end for the magician. But to me, this was an allegory of authoritarianism, where the magician is sort of an allegory or a metaphor for the authoritarian political leader who can cause the population to do things they otherwise wouldn't do. So yeah, the next story in the collection is called Disorder and Early Sorrow. It's got a date of 1925. This is all a day in the life of the Cornelius family, a middle-class German family. 1925 is this period of time between the wars when Germany had a lot of economic problems, so this family's got a lot of economic issues. They were an upper-middle-class family, though. I think the father is a professor, There are four kids, and then the parents, and then the grandparents. And to me, the one of the funny things was the two adolescent children are called the big folk, and then the two smaller children are called the little folk. The parents are called the old folk, and the grandparents are called the ancients. And the story is really, they're a happy family, but the story is really just pertaining to this day in their life, and it was a fun read. And the next story is called A Man and His Dog, from got a date of 1918. This is also called Bashan and I. So Bashan is the dog's name. So this is all about a man. His family wants to get a dog, and they get this dog as a puppy, and the dog bonds to the father, and they wind up becoming kind of best friends. And this is all a story, man and his dog kind of story. Basically, but it also pertains to really humans and I think it also pertains to humans and our interaction with the environment, because this family lives in a newish housing development that's by a river, and so this area, this wild area by a river, has been tried. They've tried to put a, this housing development on it, and then it didn't really work out. There are not that many houses, so nature's slowly taking over this housing development, the unused portion of the housing development. And this is where the man and the dog often go for walks. But this is a beautiful sort of story about a man's relationship with his dog and human relationship to nature. All right, the next story in the collection is called The Blood of the Volsungs from 1905. Well, this one's a doozy. This is kind of based on the opera Die Walküre by Wagner. And it pertains to these twins mainly, Siegmund and Sieglinde. And they're not your ordinary twins. They go around holding hands all the time. They're actually basically in love with each other. And so Sieglinde ends up having, she has this fiance who is a middle, just a regular middle class person who really idolizes her, it seems like. And but she of course has no one, eyes for no one really, but her brother. So this story's kind of strange. So I'll chat a bit more about it here in a bit. Then the next story in the collection is called Tristan from 1902. This takes place in an asylum. So again, we sort of have an intellectual type, an artistic type who is there, this man who's there. And then this woman comes in who's kind of a middle class woman who comes in to the asylum and is left there by her husband. And this sort of, I guess, author. He's a writer, but I don't think he's very successful. He doesn't seem to, he writes a lot, and he writes people letters, but no one ever writes him back. So he seems to be a really a solitary person, and he sort of idolizes and idealizes this woman eventually, and then sort of bemoans the fact that she's really, in his eyes, it seems like she's degraded herself by getting this husband, and she also has a kid, a little boy, a child. They come to visit, and he finds the whole thing repulsive because he sees her as sort of this, I guess, idealized version of who he thinks she should be. So yeah, this is another case of an artist type really not being able to fit in with a social group. So the last story in the collection is called Felix Krull, and this story is a young man whose family, he has this weird, really eccentric, hedonistic family. He learns at an early age that about acting. And so the one of the best parts of this story to me was when he goes to this theater with his father, and he sees this production, and then we have this description about this actor, about everyone loves this actor, they think he's perfect. And I think a lot of people can relate to this, because we have these Hollywood figures today, who we think are perfect examples of what it means to be a man or a woman. And so people mimic that. And so they will try to wear those clothes, try to maybe even have the accent or that kind of behavior, you know, try to copy this person. But so Felix Krull eventually goes backstage and meets this guy, though, and this guy's like nothing like his onstage persona. He's really just a very, very, very flawed, not even very attractive person once you take the makeup off and whatnot. But Felix Krull, you know, it had a vibe to me like he was on his way to becoming a con man. Maybe, you know, so had that kind of vibe of he was learning how to put on masks or put on personas to really give an impression to people around him that, you know, that wasn't necessarily true. So that's kind of what I took away from that. So, yeah, to spend a little more, go a little more in depth on a couple of these. So one, the Death in Venice itself. So the cool thing about this story to me was these two figures in the story that are kind of bookend the story. At the very beginning, the author is on this walk and he sees this man. He passes this place that are making monuments for a cemetery, and sort of out of the blue, this man appears standing by one of the monuments that are being manufactured, and they don't say anything to each other. But this seeing this person, he seems exotic. He seems like he doesn't fit with the environment, like he's not from this area, and so it causes the author, though, to sort of his mind to totally shift gears and to realize and decide that he should go on a journey. He had not been thinking of this before he went on this walk, and this shifts him and, you know, ultimately sets his fate, because then when he does get to Venice and he sees the young boy, this young boy Tadzio, that's this 14-year-old boy that he becomes obsessed with, sort of becomes the other bookend of this sort of spiritual figure that then sees him sort of the end of the story, where he is in Venice, he's ignoring the signs of an epidemic, a cholera epidemic. He stays there despite that, because he's become so obsessed with watching this boy, and, you know, ultimately he dies of the plague, of the epidemic. So to me, that was really cool, you know, that sort of bookend, and how he went from trying to not really even realizing that he had lost his youth. You know, I think this was part of what it was about, was that he had lost part of his youth because he had devoted his entire life to art and not a lot to living. And then he sees this young boy who's just starting out. He's going from being a child to a young man and just starting out. And so, you know, it triggered his, triggered that sort of emotion in him. So yeah, that's kind of what was my takeaway on it anyway. And then before I run out of time, just to touch base again on the Blood of the Volscians. So when I was reading up on this about the brother and sister, the twins that are in love with each other, you know, they wind up consummating their love at the end. So I was a little shocked by that, actually. I read that this story might have been based on Thomas Mann's wife's brother and her brother, and that her father, when the story first came out, actually asked Thomas Mann to withdraw it from publication, and he did. So I thought that was really interesting. And about Death in Venice. So, well, there was something else I was going to say about Death in Venice. Tadzio, the young boy in Death in Venice, actually was a real person. I was reading up on that, and apparently Thomas Mann's wife later on in an interview said that they saw this boy, they were in Venice, I think it was, and someone eventually found out who this boy was, and, you know, interviewed him and everything. So I thought that was pretty cool, based on an actual young boy. Okay, so I think I'm out of time with the chat. I feel like I rambled on this, but, you know, with short stories, it's kind of hard to give a coherent chat, maybe. But hopefully it was somewhat coherent. I'm really glad that I got it read. So glad. So it was really an enjoyable read. Just the beauty of the language itself, well worth the story. So my next book chat is going to be Empires of the Silk Road, A History of Central Eurasia from the Bronze Age to the Present by Christopher I. Beckwith. And I am almost finished with this, so I should have a chat on it coming up in the very near future. So until next time, take care. Bye.